Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, sporting his snazzy merch. I have joined this edition this week with the Clyde River Killer himself, Alexander Darwin MacAllan. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Billy.
So, thank you for joining me. When I've seen your previous promo work, I was a little bit apprehensive, of course, because you did kill Stephen Wilson. From Eat, Sleep, Suplex, Retweet. I don't think he's ever been the same since. But, of course, I'm not going to let you get away with not answering the first question, the boring question. How did you get into pro wrestling?
Cool. How did I get into pro wrestling? Yeah. I know you mean, but that's a boring question, because every single wrestler ever has been asked that a thousand times. Yeah, I know what I'm saying. The answer hasn't changed. So, when I reached a certain age, I made a list of things I wanted to do before I was 30. I was in bands a lot when I was younger, so I went for some singing lessons, because one thing I've never done, and then I put wrestling as the next thing on the list. So did two singing lessons. The guy was shooting me, moved to London. I don't know whether that's anything to do with how good I am at singing or a coincidence, but then I moved on to the next thing on my list, which was wrestling. Then that just took everything over. Everything else on the list became null and void, because I loved it. I've probably loved wrestling since I was a kid. So if I don't believe in regrets, but if I had any, it would be that I should have done it sooner. But that's probably how I started pro wrestling. It's not what was the actual question?
The actual was, how did you get into pro wrestling? So I mean, you can take it either way, I suppose. Yeah. So the next question would have been the opposite one. So yeah, so what first hooked you onto pro wrestling?
As a fan.
Yeah.
I remember, I was talking to somebody with this, but have I said this before? I remember, so I'm from Arica, which is a small village at the head of Loth Long. There was not a lot of people there. And when I was younger, that, you know, we didn't have Sky or anything like that. But my friend down the road had the old WWE ring with the old WWE figures you used to get. So not knowing what these were, WWF, obviously, at the time, not knowing what these were, I saw them and I was like, so there was this, you know, the one with The Undertaker with the purple gloves, and he's doing this, and he's got the hat. Of course, I just remember when I was younger thinking, that is so cool, I wonder who this guy is. And then he had all like SummerSlam 92 and all the kind of tapes and stuff like that from back then. So that was my first introduction. Then I moved to somewhere that did have Sky, and my dad would record it for me. And you know, that's when you're probably talking like Heart Foundation, DX, and that kind of bleed, sort of not quite Attitude Era yet, but bleeding from the Rocker splitting up right into the Attitude Era stuff is so yeah, I was a massive Undertaker fan, huge Shawn Michaels fan, and then, you know, just fell in love with it from there, the characters and the stories, etc.
So yeah, everyone's got a friend who has access to it in the first place, because that's how I got into it. A friend had, well, I went over to his granny's and ended up watching Undertaker and Kane Inferno match. And yeah. I was, what, 8? So this was terrifying to watch, because a guy's getting set on fire. So, yeah. But I don't know why that was just the going, I need to see more of this. I'm scared of it, but I need to see more of it. But yeah, and then it became, you needed the guy with Sky and trade tapes and what have you.
Yeah, when I moved, we had an acoustic thing going on. I had Sky, so I would record Raw and the pay-per-views. My mate had TNT, so he would record Nitro and Thunder and whatever it is, WCWs, and then obviously we'd watch them, and then we'd swap them around. So, and that was when you're getting properly in, like DX Heart Foundation, and then you're also at the start of the NWO and stuff at that time. That's the age it was that we were doing this. So each Raw Nitro was quality, right leading up to the Alliance storyline and stuff like that. So I was getting prime wrestling consumption.
You're ready when the invasion happened, whereas I was like, who's that guy?
Who's this guy?
Oh, by Mike Awesome. He was on Worldwide. That's where I remember it from. Parents though, unsung heroes. I know many times my dad had to stay up because neither of us knew how to work the VHS player to actually record at the right time. So when he was on Channel 4, he'd have to wait until, or Mum would have to wait until midnight and just go, record, and then leave. Make sure it's on Channel 4. So you start went into it was a source you started with. Is that where you started your training initially, or did you try other schools?
So I tried another school, but it worked out that they didn't. They only trained on Sundays or something. I can't remember. There was a reason why, but source was every at the time. I think it was every day when I went. Certainly, it was more during the weekday. So yeah, I went to source when it used to be. The source was it's City Gym was where source is just now, and it was two units, and it was a gym, but they had the wrestling ring in it, and that's when Damo and Nikki and were the kind of head trainers there. That's when I kind of started. So yeah, it was source I started with.
And how long was it between you starting your training and actually making your debut, which I have down as 2016, according to Cage Match?
I still don't believe Cage Match, right? Because there's no way that I've lost 33% of my matches. I don't believe that.
I'm fairly certain they haven't recorded half of them, to be honest. Because I mean, there was a good time. There was a good time where I'm sure they were not stealing, because just results, but I'm sure they were picking them up from us, and I'm sure they just have they've ignored maybe some matches that you've won. Clearly,
I dispute that. I don't remember losing ever. So what were you asking me again? Oh yeah, so a long time. I can't remember. Let me try and think this through. When was it? Must have been a good. It was because I had a spell where I started. And I was kind of light touch on it. I would consider I was doing it every week, but I wasn't really as committed as I probably would have had to have been to make the leap. Then I had have you ever heard of labyrinthis, if I'm pronouncing it correctly? It's like an inner ear infection, right?
Right.
I had that, and I could not do anything for 8 months. Like, I couldn't do anything physical. My depth perception was gone. When I was in a crowd, I couldn't focus on anything. I couldn't play five-a-side football. I definitely couldn't wrestle. So when I came back from that, is where that's when kind of handover went over and Damo and Nikki left. That I really kind of knuckled down. And I was in there three times a week, as well as, you know, being in the gym and all the right stuff you have to do to get to that level where you're able to go in front of a crowd and perform. I won't even say it was. Let me think. Probably four or 5 years. It was a reasonable amount of time.
So, I mean, important question again. But how was that first bump for you? Did you have a sporting background before? Did you do things like rugby, football, things like that?
I've never considered myself an athlete. I'm not. But I've always done some sort of sport, like. I did basketball in school. Obviously, everybody played football in the west of Scotland. So I played football, but not properly. You know, I just kind of played it leisurely. And in school, I did Muay Thai when I was very younger. So I did a little bit of martial arts there. But when I went to wrestling, probably the most exercise I was doing is I was playing five-a-side every week. So I wasn't unfit, but I was always really, really skinny. Like, I've always been a really, really, really skinny guy. It's probably a bit 2 stone lighter than I am just now when I started wrestling. I don't remember my first bump. I remember my first workout. I remember the first card workout warm-up when I came home the next day. I was just like, you know, the bit when Loki gets smashed a bit by the Hulk. It was like that, just in the morning move. But absolutely dying to go back, because the breakdown of it is so I was there for 3 hours, an hour and a half was cardio. But then the last hour and a half, that was your wrestling stuff, you know, getting in stocks and all that kind of stuff. And that, I was like, yes, brilliant. I understand this horrific cardio and push-ups and squats is the price I have to pay to do this fun stuff. So I kind of understood that after the first session. I had a point there and it's totally just jumped around my head.
Sorry, I'm sure it'll pop back in mid-sentence or something else. So I was speaking to Colton Davis, who's our last guest so far on this. Of course, the episode hasn't gone out yet. But I was pointing out to him, or asking him about the disadvantage of his height in the ring. Because, of course, yourself, Cage Match didn't have your height, so I don't have that information to hand. You're 6 foot, over 6 foot?
Yep. 6 foot four.
6 foot four. Great. Okay. So the rings typically, Scotland up here anyway, are what, 14 foot? Or
three strides.
Three, There we go. There's my next question then. So did you find you have to adapt yourself to run across the ropes? Because I know what's the typical, was it supposed to be 5 strides, I think, from watching it's Tough Enough?
Four or five. But yeah, I did. There's a lot of things like, it's funny, I was thinking about, so I was talking to some of the guys at Source and I've been thinking a lot about character. And one thing that I was thinking about is like, so I've just told you who my heroes were when I went into Tabella. I'm a big Shawn Michaels fan, right? Put the Undertaker to one side, right? It was more his character I liked than his style, but wrestling style wise, Shawn Michaels, Bret Hart, Jericho, Lance Storm, Dean Malenko, you know, this is the kind of wrestling I enjoy, that in and out reversal stuff, right? But in my mind, that's what I want to do. In reality, I'm 6'4", sometimes a foot taller than 90% of the people that are in wrestling in Scotland. I'm not as athletic as they guys are. I'm not as flexible as a lot of them are. So I can't do it to the level that they do it. And if I did do it, it's not going to be as, I'm never going to be smooth as a Grant McIver, for example, or a Craig Anthony or something like that, right? Just because of the obvious height differences between me and most of my opponents. But then the questions like, what can I do and what can I do well? And then as I learned, you know, from Damo and others, you know, use your height, use your strengths, yeah? So, yes, your height can be a bit, you know, you have to do things a bit differently, but I have no doubt that I would not have had the opportunities that I've had if I was shorter, just because there's so many people of the same height. I know it sounds like a pure weird thing to say, but like, I mean, I know I'm not downplaying myself. I worked hard and I know what I'm good at, but definitely being 6'4" has massively helped my career so far.
I mean, there's only a good handful of wrestlers in Scotland right now that I can think of off the top of my head that are over 6 foot or are considered monstrous in size. Guys like Crusher Crave, like Colton, who was 6'6", which...
Yeah.
I'm 5'10", and I think I'd pass out if I was 6'6", just from the height.
Big one.
Yeah.
Scary thing is he's still young as well, so I don't know if he... I remember, I don't think... He was maybe my height when he started, and then he came back next week and he was taller than me. I was like, oh, hold on, that's cheeky.
Just like going, no, this is my thing.
How dare you, sir?
You stoop. That's what you can do instead. So from there, of course, you started with Source. Can't remember what comes first. I'm assuming it's the tag title win. So you went from Source. They were still under SWA at the time, I think.
When I debuted, you're right. Because my second show I was on was an SWA show up in... what's that place called? Past Inveridian. It was miles away. We had to drive for ages. It was like a bought-in show, and it was like my second and third match was there. So yeah, it was still under the SWA banner. You're right.
No, that's too long ago. So it wouldn't be Rock and Wrestle or anything like that.
It wasn't as far as that. It was. They still do shows now, but it's GPWA do them now.
Tarbert.
Yeah. Do you know it is Tarbert because Tarbert. It's just beside Attica where I grew up. But Tarbert, no. What was the one you said?
Tarbert.
Tarbert is way within the three locks. Because I remember when we first said, I was like, oh, that's great. I can visit my gran. And then I was like, oh, no, it's over.
So you started as a tag team. That was your initial run. Of course, part of the Titans. And, of course, become SWA tag team champions, defeating Solar and Lucha DS. So I've got all my notes. So what was it like starting off that first match then? Was it the tag team you started with, or was it just a singles match in front of an actual paying crowd?
Yeah, so the first paying crowd match was a tag match. And it was, I mean, I've said this to some of the guys that debuted, like, I don't know if other people agree with me, but it's just my opinion. Your first few matches, there's a while before you go, oh yeah, there's a crowd there. Where you're just, you're to make a fool of yourself or whatever the thing is. So yeah, first match was at Source. It was one of our kind of showcases. It was a tag match. It was fun. I just remember it being really fun. It wasn't, obviously, I think probably it was the, I don't really get nervous before matches, but I was nervous before that one, obviously. And then, as I say, it was just fun. And it was actually the day before my birthday as well. So that was quite nice. And it was a nice night afterwards. And then it progressed that we got a lot of good tag opportunities and a lot of good tag teams, you know, like the Poles and Just Us and I'm sure I'm doing some of their disservice here. There's some cracking teams that we got to wrestle. And then obviously eventually we got to wrestling Paisley against Lucha Scotland, if that's what they went by when we wrestled them, I can't remember. And you know, that was massive. I remember when I first started training at Source, and I said this to them both the other day. It's such a silly thing, but I remember seeing DCT and Adam Carell, who was when they were Moutash. Don't know if you remember Moutash.
I do. Yes.
Yeah. So I remember when they won the SWU titles, and it was just that. Man, I like that. I like both of them. They're lovely guys, and they're always really nice to me. So I saw them with that and I was like, that's really cool. I'd like those one day. And I did. So yeah, that meant something to me.
I apologise if you hear any whining in the background here. My dog has decided to join me for a moment.
My dog would be going ballistic, so I've just shut the door.
Oh no, Sandy likes to chew something really loudly outside the door when I'm recording, unless she comes in and then just whinges for no reason. I think it's just jealousy. I think she just wants more attention.
Sable's exactly the same.
Just speaking into Sable. You started 97.
You know, that's funny. So we got my dog's a rough collie, yeah. So you know, like Lassie. So we picked her up, and my wife was like, "What are we going to call her?" And I was like, "Oh, I don't know." And she's like Sable's the cut. So I don't know if you know rough collies. You get Tricolour, Merrill, and Sable. That's the three different types. So the Lassie type's the kind of goldy white one. The ones you get are black and white, and that are Tricolour. And then the ones that are like the grey with the blue eyes, usually they're Merrill. So Sandra's like, "We'll call her Sable after the colour." And I was like, "You know, I'm going to have to explain this to everybody." Like, wasn't even particularly a big Sable fan, to be perfectly honest. Well, probably the age I was, but I wasn't particularly, you know, massive on Sable. So no, it's the colour she's named after, not the
colour. Well, mine's called Santa Claus because we bought her got her in December, and my wife's a humongous fan, Nightmare Before Christmas, and she's blonde. So Santa, it all worked out. Well, she's called other things, but I can't. If I'm breaking my explicit rule, if I start saying what I actually call her most of the time, because she's a...
You just said maybe actually Oogie Boogie would be a great name for a dog.
Imagine in the park just shouting that. Just going, "Right, Oogie Boogie. That's why she's called Sandy most of the time, because I just feel like I look like an idiot going, "Sandy Claus."
The dog's like, you will address me by my full title.
Exactly. you will call me my whole name, or I will not come back. I will just continue rummaging through this dead bird for hours on it. Absolute
dogs.
So winning that title, then yeah, you said you saw Moutash win it, and yeah, you said, "Right, I want a piece of that." What was it like holding your first championship belt itself?
I can't remember if that was my first one or the Source one was my first one. I can't remember what way around it was.
Well, Source is 2018, so I'm thinking tag title was 2017, possibly ish.
Oh, Source one was my first one.
I didn't write it down. I thought that I would possibly just be able to.
You would think I would remember, to be fair, Billy. It was me that did it, so I'm not, not faulting you, but I'm sure I won the Source title first.
We'll speak about the Source one then. That's fine. Yeah, so the Source. So the Source Championship, we'll go quick history for those that are unaware. You went through a tournament. It was a vacant championship, first championship for Source Wrestling, as Source Wrestling, out with the SWA banner. You defeated the following names in this tournament: Joe Coffey, Grant McIver, Kieran Kelly, and Mike Bird in the final. Mm-hmm. Quite a roster of names to defeat. Yeah. Well, we'll go for the end question first. How did it feel winning your first championship?
Yeah, that was the probably so far the most emotive I've reacted to kind of that. I think it's just, it was a combination of, it was a long weekend. There's quite a lot. Cause on top of four matches, there was two seminars that I also attended that were pretty, you know, I think Mike Bailey and Jordan Devlin were the two that did seminars during that weekend. So they weren't easy. So I was knackered, I was sore. On top of that, like I obviously with the amount of years I've been there and the people I've worked with, I've got a real affinity with Source. It's you know, my home promotion, it's where I was trained, and it's kind of like a family a lot, the way we are in Source. So to be the kind of figurehead for the first championship for that promotion and to represent those people that mean a lot to me, it was so important. And I think more than that, and I said this, I think Sean McLaughlin afterwards, I said to him, like, I never even thought I'd be good enough to wrestle, never mind to hold a championship. So to you know, to achieve that, it was massive for me. So yeah, that all those emotions all came at one time. So that was the first kind of belief of, you know what, I actually might be all right. I might not just be decent, or you know, I might be actually quite good at this. So yeah, it felt really, really good.
It must be one of those feelings as well, because I mean, in the whole age of wrestling thing, you came in quite a bit later than those that it's that DDP thing, Batista. Yeah. Level of yeah. Going right. I'm a bit older.
You're younger than them, mate.
when they started, I mean, what was DDP? What, 33 or something? Yeah, I mean, you're still a bit younger than that, so that's fine. But yeah, so it's that obviously that thought of, oh, I'm too old to. It's the merch thing.
It's a good point, because I remember I was hung up on it big when I first started training, and I was 28 when I first started training. So I messaged Demo. I didn't know it was Demo at the time. I messaged Source and it was Demo. And I was like, do you think this is too old stuff? He's like, no, just come along. So I was like, cool. And then I must have asked, you know, people every now and then, are you sure? Then eventually, like, I just forgot about it. And now I never think about my age. Like, it's, you just do things until you can't do them anymore, or it's not comfortable, or it's not safe. Like, it doesn't matter. And then I've seen other people who are even younger than me that have went to my tool, like, try it and see, or whatever. You know, there's people who are 20 who won't be able to do it, and there's people who are 34 that they will. Like, it's just ages. You know, my dad's god, mid-50s, and he's fitter than anybody my age, including me. He's an absolute beast. So yeah, it's just, you know, age is just a number, as they say.
That's the thing. I mean, back in ye olde days, what Macho Man and Hulk Hogan were considered old when they hit 35, 40. Yeah. Of course, a lot more went into their bodies than just working out at that point. But nowadays,
Slim Jims.
yeah, definitely Slim Jims is what we're going to call it. But nowadays, your top level guys are pushing 50. We got AJ Styles, just John Cena, even when he comes back as well. They're in the 40 to 50 age bracket nowadays. So it's
people are a lot smarter on like their sports science and their fitness and diet and things like that. So it's more easily accessible with the internet and being like, society seems to be wanting to be a lot healthier. So it's easier to keep yourself in good condition. Not that I'm saying I'm in good condition, because I'm not a body guy, but you know, I'm not going to hurt anyone. I'm pretty fit. I'm good. Well, in fact, I'm doing myself a disservice. I'm in decent shape.
No one's going to judge you. You just say that you're the best around. It's fine. So go
for it. Don't worry. We'll get to that.
So you had a very lengthy run as Source Wrestling Champion. You had, I did have in my previous notes before I wrote them, who you faced along the way, some of your bigger opponents, bigger named opponents. From a great mix, including, off the top of my head now, I'm going, do you have a match with Sugar Dunkerton? Am I right in thinking that? Sami Zayn, and then a plethora of talents from Source themselves before, unfortunately, losing the title to Grant McIver. Who you've already said something positive about in this podcast, whether you meant to or not. He was going on about going on about, like he talked about for the whole time. he was saying that for him it was a culmination of a humongous story from that tournament itself. Yeah. So for you, what was it? What were your initial feelings of your first championship reign in Source coming to an end?
So I love stories. Stories, that's why I do this. Like, to know how far ahead that story was going to go, I kind of knew what I wanted to do along the way. So Grant's bang on. It was a culmination of a whole host of little bits and bobs that we'd done along the way with him and with Kieran and with Luke Matthews and various others that kind of went along the way. And because Grant, that was, I think, 3 or 4 times from the tournament match and then another 3 title shots that he couldn't beat me one-on-one. Then in a four-way, he still didn't beat me. He pinned Kieran Kelly. So it's that story, but he had to do it nefariously. So if anything, the story for me in that is that he beat me by being like me. So in the end, I kind of won, if that makes sense. In the whole supervillain type archetypical way. But at the same time, my character learned something about himself and changed to being, you know, less villainous, but no less nasty. So that Govan match and that whole title run, I'm immensely proud of, because I was given the chance to run with it, and we did. And more than that, it's working with the guys who obviously I trained with. One of my probably the match I'm most proud of is a match that probably hardly anybody's seen. There was if I say there was 20 people there and somebody told me there was 10, I wouldn't argue with them. It was something like that. And it was in Mount Vernon versus Grant. And it was me and Grant put together. I dare say we asked some people's opinions on it or whatever. But everything, every single little spot, everything we needed people to bite on. I swear at one point, the bold Jack McIver, Grant's dad, was jumping his seat because he thought his son had beat me. There was tears and everything. It was great. But he didn't, and I beat him. And that I'm very proud of, because Grant and I, who you know, were peers, because we both debuted not 2 million miles away from each other. That's the first time I walked back and went, yeah, I'm a professional wrestler. I'm good at this. I can go out and I can tell those stories, and I can entertain a crowd, you know, any day of the week. But yeah, a lot of good things came out of that.
Yeah, I mean, not only that, you end up making your debut in Reckless Intent. Because I think there was a bit of a little bit of a brand warfare kind of thing, interpromotional thing. You end up defending the title a couple of times in Reckless.
Mm-hmm. That was fun.
So you went from so I didn't even speak about the Violence Institute, but you went from the Titans to the Violence Institute, and then now it's Killer Zero, with Zero, of course. Yeah. So how did that tag team come about?
Cool. You had the Violence Institute, which was the Titans, Luke Matthews, Matt Daly, and Zero. Then my rampant ego manages to get rid of all of them apart from Killer, apart from Zero, who's, you know, well documented, a very, very good friend of mine in wrestling and still is. And then I needed a tag partner to face Age of Orion. Zero was the one, so then we thought, you know, Killer Zero, pretty cool name. Zero is likes his Japanese wrestling and Japanese stuff, and I thought Killer Zero in the kind of Suzuki gun frame of names of tag teams is pretty cool. So and the entrance music he chose for us is fun. I love it, and I hate that we don't tag often because I don't get to hear it, because it's great. It's from a computer game or something. If you don't mind, there's this theme I think we can maybe use, and I listen to him like, Matt, that's absolutely perfect. It's like the pure, because you know, I was using Karma Barima before, and he uses, I can't remember what it is, it's something else, like a Belzy one, and this was just a perfect thing. Like, that's perfect. I'll need to find it, I'll send it to you, but I'm like, that's perfect, it's so good. And the thing Zero's really good at is he's describing it to me. He's like, at this bit, I think you should do this, and then I'll do this, and then it'll look like this, and I'm like,
so take your word for it. That's fine.
No, well, he's a genius in some ways.
So I mean, your whole character in Source, it started off with this very Undertaker-esque, brooding, scary person. There's probably a really fancy word that's just not going to my head. I wrote down that I find yourself being the conscience of Source Wrestling, much like JR would call the Undertaker back in the day, because it seems to be, if something happens in Source, from my perspective anyway, as just reading results or watching it on YouTube, everything comes through you somehow eventually. Which is quite a cool position to be in, being kind of like the godfather, so to speak, like head of the table. If something's going on, I need to know about it. So you tell me. But what was your thought? What was your thought process behind the Clyde River Killer? Was it taking that Undertaker elements in?
So that kind of is an evolution thing where when I started very much in my head. Sort of arrogance is that was always what I was like. If I'm going to be a bad guy, I'm going to be arrogant. Like 90s Shawn Michaels. That was, you know, that's I loved that. That was so cool. So I'm going to do that. So I kind of started down that vein, and then kind of like any good building of anything. Like somebody once said to me, like, if you're going to do something like that, don't think wrestling. Think movies or TV or music. So like I'm like oddly. I know a lot of people are, but like I find serial killer stuff fascinating. I always have. I thought it was really, really cool. As well as I like a lot of my musical tastes are more like metal and all and stuff like that. And the films I watch and TV series and stuff. So I took a little bit of like Mads Mikkelsen's Hannibal, a little bit of Dexter, a little bit of various other bits and bobs of that kind of thing, and I kind of created this. Clyde River Killer, and that came about because obviously I was EDM. I'm EDM. For me, EDM was that kind of arrogant, too rich to fail type, you know, more Bateman as a serial killer. And then I just thought there was something missing, and I wanted a kind of moniker, like I think the Green River Killer is kind of where I got that from. Or something like the Boston Strangler or you know, something along those lines. So I had a few that I tried out, and I spoke to some people about it, and I didn't like Clyde River Killer. I was like, I don't like it, because it's the River Clyde and we don't really call it that here. I was like, it didn't sit in my ear nicely. So I spoke to Billy Kirkwood, and I said, look, this is something I don't know what am I like, you know, what do you think? So I think one of the square goes, He says in commentary that the Clyde River Ripper, and I listened to it back, and I was like, no, I don't like that.
That's worse.
That's worse. there's a Tenacious D song. It's like that's worse. Off to a bad start. So I was like, no, Clyde River Killer. So the more I said it, like Simon Cassidy said to me once, he's like, that's so good. I was like, cool, there we go. Simon reads out people's names for a living. So I'll stick with it.
So was the Alexander Darwin MacAllan, was the ADM bit also a conscious decision, because you got guys like your MVP and stuff like that, that it just becomes a what's the word, pseudonym, is that the word? Instead, is that again another conscious decision when you were coming up with your character?
No, so originally, like my grandfather was Kane, actual K-A-N-E, that's how his name, so Alexander Kane. Was kind of what I wanted, but I was doing a seminar with Glenn Joseph, who's one of the owns Progress and runs NXT UK, etc. And he was doing promos because Glenn's got like an acting and theatrical background, so that's what he was there to kind of show us to how to, you know, act. So I was cutting promos, he was loving them, I was using that name, and then I asked him about it, and he was like, oh no, it should be fine. So then a couple of days later, he messaged somebody who said to me, like, you know, Glenn's, like, he said, look, don't, he's like, anything that's even a little bit like something else, just don't, there's no point. You'll always be affiliated with that big famous thing that's going to be the thing. So it was like, cool. So back to the drawing board. So, I wanted a triple barrel name because a lot of assassins and serial killers, Lee Harvey Oswald, John Wayne Gacy, so forth, they've got triple barrel names. And I wanted Alexander because it's my grandfather's name. So the ADM thing is an absolute blessing. And when I realised how lucky I was, we had like, 60 to 100 posters to sign for SWA once. And I'm watching, who was on the show? I'm trying to think of some of the names that were on that were a bit lengthier. I'm watching them, and I'm just like three letters underlined. I'm like, GBL's a genius.
So I think like take your initials, it means something. My initials is WCS. So I am toilets, if anyone takes my initials. So that's why I go for BCS. But if I go for BS, it's something else as well. So my parents really, really stuck me with a really rubbish one to go with if I'm ever going to go, right, I'll wrestle my real name. That's never going
to
happen.
Well, my advice to anyone is don't use your real name. Loads of people have ignored me and done it, which is fine. It's totally your taste, totally up to you. But my real name is pretty boring and not very showbiz, so...
I mean, if it's worked for... likes of Ellen John and that changed their name to something a bit flashier. Why not?
Yeah. I mean, I was watching a thing on Harley Race and it was his dad said to him, because he was going to choose a different name, his dad said, why would you want to make someone else's name famous? I was like, that's pretty cool. Can't argue with that. But I just think, because it helps as well that, like, even right now, you're not talking to the guy who, you're talking to ADM just now, right? But it helps me just not be, you know, it's two different. It's a little bit of the guy underneath this, but it just helps you separate the two things. And it means you care less about trolls and things like that because they're not important to you. You're just your character is made up. Like,
I super appreciated that you signed into Zoom just as ADM because really, I want to know as little as possible about the actual
person
by the name because. It weird sight for me because I met Ricochet. I was doing some work for Rock and Wrestle and work.
The Irish gunfighter.
Ricochet. And I met him in the Mercure, some hotel. I can't remember. I was picking him up, and he came up to me and went, "Oh hi, I'm Trevor." No, you're
not. Yeah.
No, you're not. So it's just no, and it just. I now see Ricochet doing all these flashy moves, amazing. And I was like, you introduced yourself to me as Trevor, and I will never not think of that every time I see you wrestle now.
Yeah.
I mean, I met guys like Colt and Sanjay Dutt, and they were like, this is what they just introduced themselves as a wrestling name. Great. That's all I need to know.
Yeah.
But oh, no, Trevor. And it's the least showbiz name in the world. It's the
hard one because I get like, I'm careful what I say here, right? But like, I'll start off by saying, right, I don't have any kind of people to bury in. Everybody I've ever spoke to or worked with in wrestling has been lovely to me, right? I've never face-to-face with any trouble with anybody. But I'd imagine through the grapevine and through Twitter and stuff, especially in America and things like that, there's wrestlers who forget they were wrestling fans. So I'm always very conscious, like, if I met you in person, I will probably tell you my real name. Yeah, just because I don't want you thinking that I'm big leaguing you by using like my pseudonym. But at the same time, though, there's a mystique gone. Like, I never want to see Zero sit and do what we are doing just now. I'd hate if Zero sat and done. I mean, fair play if he does, right? But the less you know about that character, the absolute better that character is. I'm a bit different because I'm based a little bit more in reality, so I can get that I can bridge a gap. And, you know, we've all watched that Undertaker documentary now, so the character, you can't put toothpaste back in the tube now. We've watched our hero that was an absolute like legend, you know, sitting, talking to Roman Reigns and his wife, and, you know, you can watch them kind of like, all right, yeah, we better be going now. So you know, there is an element, like I'm kind of, because even like this, the way we're chatting just now, I was always in two minds whether I do this or not, because it ruins the mystique. But at the same time, you know, I'm not going to bring kayfabe back, am I? So
I always find with yourself, it works for you, because your character's evolved from just being a bit broody and a bit scary and all that to just like a serial killer just talking. But yeah, the tone you use makes all the difference. I mean, the line you had on the WWE Network, you do a lot of talking if it was your funeral or day before your funeral. Yeah. I thought it's just such a little line, but the tone on it just makes all the difference. So I mean, you could do this, and you could. I don't think we're gonna ruin ADM.
Yeah, exactly. And as the switch, you could easily, you know, you can switch between talking like this to talking like that. It's crazy. And that line, like everything in wrestling, was stolen.
I mean, I'm gonna steal an analogy anyway, which I've can't remember who came up with it. I heard it so long ago, but the biggest marks in wrestling are wrestlers.
Oh yeah, massively.
Because they actually went, oh, this is quite cool, that I'm gonna do it. So I mean, if I ever see a wrestler trying, nay, big league and bit going, oh, you marks, I'm like, you're the biggest one here, you did it. So
I have paid hundreds of pounds to learn to wrestle. Like, how could I possibly criticize someone that, you know, for being a fan? Like my only thing that's probably, you, not to get like arguments with people and stuff like that, but I do believe that like any fan is entitled to an opinion, unless your opinion on is how that's being performed. In the same way that I can tell you my dishwasher's broke, but I can't tell my plumber that he didn't fix it right unless I see it's not working, if that makes sense. So the intricacies of it, if you've not done it, yeah, you can have an opinion on it, that's fine, you can speak about it, but don't be offended if someone who actually has spent hours crafting that art turns around and says to you, well, no, I don't agree with you, if you know where I'm coming from.
Oh yeah, I mean, that's why I've kind of tried to stop writing as many reviews now, because I'm in that opinion where I can criticise something. I feel like if I've got to criticise it, I feel like if I've got to criticise it, I have to balance it with a reason. So I can't go, oh, that move was a bit rubbish. I can go, well, that didn't look great. But if this happened, just a little tweak. I mean, then I'm still speaking to someone who's never done it. I've never taken a bump. I don't plan to. So
it doesn't make your opinion any less valid than mine, unless it comes to, I don't know, you criticising how I did a wrist lock reversal, and then I'd say, well, either I'd say you're right, or I would say, well, no, because X, Y, and Z. So, because some things you don't know. So you could go, like, you know, that spot looks stupid, but what you don't know is that that guy's just saved that guy's life because he slipped. You know, it's things like that you might not know. So that's where I come. At the same time, like, there's too much criticism, but there's not enough right criticism. It's probably... and everything, to be honest, that's just how life is these days.
Yeah, we're totally sidetracking, but there's definitely ways to react to that kind of criticism as well. Because I had one guy. Well, I'll tell you, was because I spoke to him about it. But it's Omar Mohammed. Mm-hmm. I watched his first match on W3L Action Academy. Don't watch it. The show itself is awful, but it was so bad, and I just end up just ripping on his shoes because he was wearing Converse, and it annoyed me so much for the whole time. And he didn't take it personally. He just took it as like a learning experience. And then there's another guy that I mercilessly, who I called him, I said he was like a fish had come out of the water because he was so floppy, and he thought I hated him. I was like, no, I don't hate you.
Aye,
that like was that. Rubbish, but don't hate you. So calm down. So many people go, do you hate me? Like, no. Why? Yeah. Oh, you said this about my match. Well, it wasn't very good, was it? So I mean, I can't.
I've never met you. Do you know what I mean? And at the same time, like, that's a prime example. Like, so if you had something like that against, like you said something about that against me, right? Like, that's, you're saying, you as a, what's the word I'm looking for? You're not, you're the journalist part of Billy Strachan, right? Yeah. Talking about the wrestler part of me. So that's detached. I don't, like, you know, it's not as if you're coming in and criticizing how I've decorated my living room. You're talking about how I've approached the, you know, the art form that I'm performing. So I'm like, you know, like, one, I mean, you're one person, and two, I don't know you, so who cares?
Exactly. I mean, if anything, you could spin it as, I mean, there'll be guys that have done, that have read my reviews and went in big old character on Twitter and called me out on it. I was like, that's fine. It's getting me hits. I don't care. You just, next time, don't do it, and I won't say. So that's just easy as that. But no, I have had a few in the past going, do you hate me? It's like, no, but you're wrestling that.
Everybody knows you don't hate anyone. You just love Aspen Faith more than everybody else.
I think there's a couple that Kyle Watt, I'll just shout him out for it. I think he loves him a little bit more than I do, which, but has he ever cried when he's lost a match? I don't think so. I've done that, sadly. twice. From my wife was one of them, which was even worse. But yeah, it's not the most manliest of things, but it was passionate. I'll say that.
Anyway, it's like, just talking about that, right? So I think it was John Barrowman at a Comic-Con, and somebody said something to him about it being like nerdy or whatever, and he said, he's like, don't you ever apologize for having a passion. If anybody criticizes you for that, they've just not found the thing that they're that passionate about. So I see no harm in you crying about Aspen Mosen. You fill your boots, mate. That's emoted with you. Express yourself. No problem with it.
Oh, it's even worse. The whole day, it was one of the Eagle Rumbles. The whole day I was going, I think Aspen's going to win. And I told my wife, I was like, I think Aspen's going to win. I'm so confident that he's going to win. And then the way he was eliminated, he was like cockily going over the top rope, and then he slipped on the apron and fell out. I mean, it was the last three, one of the last three. And I was just, I looked at her and was like, who's going
to
win?
I can relate to that. You weren't upset because Aspen lost. You were upset because you were wrong. I totally get that. I hate being wrong as well, mate. I'd have cried as well.
But no, second time I'll start ranting about WrestleZone because their table match stipulations were just ridiculous. And I'll get someone from WrestleZone in the future. And actually, I think I did annoy Scotty in our first episode of season two about it because they broke the announce table, but it didn't count. It wasn't an active table. Anyway, right. I'm gonna move on because it just annoyed me at the time and it brings up bad memories. So 2020 was a bit rubbish, but you made your debut in Discovery Wrestling.
I did, yes, I did.
And it was at the raffle show.
Yes, it was. That was awesome. That was really good.
Handicap match against the Sam Barber Experience, team with Zero, of course. So it was like, Discovery is probably one of the more bigger companies in Scotland, I would say, right now. So it was like picking the raffle ticket and getting on the show.
That was good. It was good. I've wanted to work for them for a long time. Like, I like the product because it's very, I don't know, it's a, even their fan base, it's so hard to explain. They're like, the wrestling is like, how can I put it? It's like a family crowd atmosphere, but wrestling crowd wrestling, if that makes sense. So it's like, if NXT was Butlins a little, if that makes sense to you. And it was a learning experience as well, because I went out there and things got reactions that wouldn't, because the crowd to me, mentally, I would perform more as if it was a Source crowd than it was, for example, an ICW crowd. Whereas that's not entirely correct. They're fans of, you know, they're wrestling fans. They like wrestling, you know. I remember a four-armed Sam and everybody was, and then there was the reaction. I was like, oh, I've got this wrong. And then the pop for the pile driver as well. And I was like, oh, good. People know what a pile driver is. Excellent. So, yeah, I think next time, and there will be a next time, I'm positive I'll be back at the disco. Well, unless I've just offended Alan by being so cocky about it. Hopefully I'll be back at disco as well. I'll have already learned something from just that one kind of handicap match with Sam. But I'm gutted the Jam House is going. That was so good. So good. Just everything about it, the lights, the layout. Oh, fantastic. The creepy room you need to walk past, it's probably haunted.
wrap your wheelhouse then with the creepiness.
Oh, me and Zero as well. We're loving it.
But yeah, that's it. Discovery is, I'm not going to say NXT Butlins, but it's definitely got that NXT vibe where everyone's coming to see wrestling, yeah. But there's ones coming to see the names, because I mean they've had the Elite there, yeah. Which I don't watch being the Elite. I don't watch AEW at the moment either, but I know who Kenny Omega and the Young Bucks are.
Yeah.
Well, for me, the Young Bucks will always be Generation Me for those TNA fans there. They're watching and listening. I want that throwback. But just seeing the fans react to them, I knew they were a big deal, yeah. Because they were there to see wrestling. Plus, it's Edinburgh, and you can get a train just about anywhere to Edinburgh, yeah. In Scotland. And it's like a nice day out. They do afternoon shows, which I love. So next, yeah. I'm hoping to get down to Edinburgh at some point. Wife wants me to go down so badly because she thinks, oh, you'll love Edinburgh. And I'll be like, yeah, wait. I'll go wait for some dates to come up. When's Discovery doing an afternoon show in Edinburgh? And then, yeah, we'll definitely go down to Edinburgh and go.
My tip is don't drive there.
Oh, no, I did that once. It was first and last time.
Nightmare. I had to like crash into a tram when I was driving us back. So where am I? Nightmare. But,
oh, no, I did it once. I was kind of coerced into it again doing that rock and wrestle stuff. I was asked if I could you drive us down to Edinburgh for a show? No bother, that's fine. You're paying for my petrol. I ended up paying for a hire because I only had a Clio and there was five people to get into this car. And I got all the way down, picked up some folk, and then I just sat there looking at trams, looking at the sat nav, thinking, I can't go down that road. Can I? Eventually I just gave up and just went, no, I'm leaving the sat nav. If anyone pulls me over, it's their fault. I'm blaming it on them. But no, it's a nightmare of a place.
It's a nightmare driving in. The pleasant surprise to me was that there was parking just right there beside the jam house. I didn't need to pay for it. I was ecstatic. Hence double gutted that the jam house is gone. Do you know what? I hope I'm not speaking out of turn. I'm sure Alan will let me know. But that match was actually supposed to be me and Zero versus Jerry Bakewell, which I think would have been hilarious. So if you're aware of Jerry Bakewell's work?
I am aware of the fabulous Bakewells and their work. They were one of the early names in disco as well. They kind of disappeared. Yeah. Then.
So like I thought it was amazing. But there was like, I think, I don't know if it was it COVID or was it was there a dust cloud or something? Something that was stopping flights coming to London anyway, or Yorkshire, I guess is where he's from. And Sam was about, I've said for years I wanted to wrestle Sam anyway. I still love to do it one on one, but it was good, fun, enjoyed it.
Not only that, I mean, in 2019 you did make appearances for Respect, as far as I'm aware off the top of my head. But in 2020, before all the shows went haywire and didn't happen, you won the Respect Championship against Robbie Solar. Sorry, Robbie Wishart, totally different Robbie guy. Wishart. Yep. Which is strange because I think his Mexican cousin was the one you beat for the tag titles in SWA as well. So what was it like coming into Respect again? Not so much a new company because there's a lot of familiar faces in there, and just going after their top title and winning it.
It was a skoosh. No, the thing I like about Respect is like it's the same again. Like when you go and you work in different places, there's always something a little bit like different about them, and through in Respect, it's always full, right? Always a set place, always jam packed. Kids and adults, they're there to have fun, they're there to have a laugh. They're maybe not, you know, as wrestling savvy as a disco crowd, for example, right? But they're no less loud, and they are so easy to bam up. It is a dream for, especially when you know, they can hear you. I've said some frankly horrible things to the crowds at Respect and they've loved it and it's been great. And also as well as that, like every time I've been there, I've wrestled something really, really, really good. Like I remember, was it the first time I was there, was me and Jack Morris. It's me versus Jack Morris. That was good. I wrestled Lucha DS, wrestled Dunbar, I'm doing some of the disservice here.
That's the journey. So they probably don't have those matches because they're a bit weird with your win-loss record.
This one's other missing no one. And then obviously Wishart, which is one of my favourite opponents. Like I've wrestled Robbie and his cousin numerous times. And trained with them obviously, and we had a cracking match in Source once where I tried to hit him with a broom and he moved and it snapped. I actually literally tried to kill him. That was probably where the Clyde River Killer started, to be honest, trying to murder Robert Wishart's cousin with a broom. The title match was fun as well, big crowd. I did something in it that I don't know if it was recorded, but I will do it again because it was one of these things I could hear. Not so much the fans, but I heard the lads going, ooh, so I'm definitely, it'll make an appearance at some point.
A gif of some description in the future.
Oh, it's a gif. It's very gifable. For a guy who just does forearms, I need something gifable.
So even with the pandemic on, you've ended up appearing on the WWE Network.
Yes, I know. Imagine that.
So you're on in the Lionheart League. Well, I think your bracket's just, well, we've definitely ended by the time this episode goes out. Yeah. But you had one win, two losses?
One win, two losses, yeah. A question. I'll be writing to them about the third loss, though.
So what was it like going in? Well, one wins against Ian Skinner, of course. But so just to get his name in there. So what was it like wrestling in front of no
crowd? Edit that out. I'm not giving out any of your time.
I think he's got some questions. He might have some questions for you, but no, he doesn't. It's fine. What was it like wrestling in front of like nobody, no crowd at all?
Do you know, oddly fine. Really, really oddly, never really. I don't know how you describe it. It's weird. Like, at first, it's odd because I do a lot of conversing during my entrance. That's generally what I kind of try and do. Not a lot, but you know, some. And then usually when I'm in there, I'll talk quite a lot to the crowd because they're there. That's when it was weird. But it wasn't until, somebody said to me, look, that's your crowd. There's that thing there. That's everybody that's watching. And, you know, that's who you're playing to. So that after that, I was like, yeah, okay, cool. That kind of made it easier to do. But, you know, strangely, not having a crowd didn't think it affected it that much. And I've not actually spoke to a lot of the people that were on it to see if they feel the same way, but I was not saying I didn't miss the crowd, but I didn't really feel I was hampered by a lack of crowd.
I suppose the only kind of performance I can compare it to just now is like a Roman Reigns, as in he uses his match and the lack of crowd to tell you the story as it goes along, has been one of those things which has been quite a bright spark in the whole COVID era of pro wrestling. But so you can, your confrontation and the story that was put between you and DCT, for example, which spawned that funeral line that you did in the pre-match, it just made the match bigger because I didn't know there was any inherent history between the two of you, but the two of you created it. And it made it
Billy and GRK are phenomenal. Like, they're so good at what they do, of making me seem like a threat, and putting that history between me and D as well. So they definitely, as much as me and D kind of, we baked the cake, they kind of put the icing and stuff on it as well. So I'm trying to pick dog fur off my keyboard while I'm talking to you. I'm sure you sympathise. Commentary was, I messaged them because I was blown away. It was really good, and I'm very, very proud of that match. Like, that's one I can kind of hang my hat on and go, yeah, we told a story, and that's what I wanted to do.
Well, I think it was after that match I messaged you as well. It was just saying, I'm not going to do that whole message because other things, of course, but I was just like, that's what I want to see. That's pretty much the gist of it. It's an odd time, like how much I can how much we can speak about the whole things, but it's still cool seeing people like yourself and Grant McIver and all that on the WWE network. So
yeah.
If you told yourself back in 2016 you're making your debut, that 4 or 5 years down the line you'd be on WWE's 999 brand new network, what would you have believed it? What would have been your what would have been your reaction, you think?
Of course not. I don't even think I was going to, you know, become a wrestler, never mind become one. That, you know, through luck, talent or whatever, I managed to get to the level I'm at now where I'm you know, I'm on the WWE network and people are talking about it. The fact that, you know, Vince McMahon might accidentally look me up when he's looking for JBL and he's not got his glasses is mind-blowing to me.
Just the thought of it. I mean, that's just mind-blowing to think that, yeah, Vince McMahon, if he knows how to use the network itself, will be putting A in looking for, I don't know, Aaron Anderson to scowl at, and your name will pop up. And yeah, it's just absolute insane, pardon the pun, that. So we're going to go to the fan questions, because I did write down that you did have a match against Shug D for the source title. So we've got some questions on here. We've got plenty, which is really nice, which saves me a little bit of work. So Brent Carter kicked us off with, do you actually kill people in the Clyde, or are you just a general purpose killer who happens to live near the particular river?
Yeah, it's geographical. I'm a killer who's geographically based in the Clyde area, although his kills are not limited to the area of the Clyde.
A very well thought out answer. Any particular favourites? I mean, you mentioned a few as you were going along with the triple barrel names, and any particular serial killers that interest you? Not obviously for their body of work, but just their stories and their conspiracies or what have you.
Well, Zodiac. Still, did they catch him? Zodiac killer. That's madness. There's one. What's his name? I'm sure his surname's Ramirez, but he killed between Mexico and USA, so they think he might be the most prolific serial killer of all time, because they cannot tell how many people he's killed, but they think it might be in like the 400s. So that's I'm sure that's the case. I was in a book I read somewhere. I read it in a book. Dodgeball reference, I think. That's pretty interesting. Zodiac's cool too.
So we've got Stephen Louch coming in. He's returned a question that I didn't actually ask him, that you asked me to ask him in our podcast, because I forgot it. So he's put, who are your favourite famous people that share your initials?
Well, I don't think there's any that share ADM, so he's got me there.
How high does this go?
I don't actually know what he means by that, but to the top.
I'm assuming I'm going to get quite a lot of weird questions that I won't know the answers to either. Did somebody get hurted?
I don't know the answer to that, but yes, they probably did if I was involved.
Manlin's asked, favourite shoot interview?
any honky tonk man interview, me and Manlin absolutely adore. We love it. And another one, if I can explain why. So I was talking to Taylor Wright about this actually. There's a Teddy Hart interview, right? Teddy Hart is, you know, I don't know the guy, but I think he's probably human garbage, right? Everything you hear about him, he's not a very nice guy. You know, I hate to give him any publicity, right? But there's an interview with him where he's talking about his fight with CM Punk. And I can't remember how I came across it. It popped up on like a YouTube thing, and I'm watching him going, he talks like Donald Trump. Like, as if he's like, what's he said? Taylor was saying it word for word and putting in Trump. And I'm like, yeah, Trump would say that. It's like, nobody was like me. I'm so athletic and fast and strong and light. And just the way he says it, I'm like, that's like Donald Trump. This guy's mental. So yeah, that I enjoyed that, but purely just for making fun of it, not for Teddy Hart. But honky tonk man, any honky tonk man story, me and Manlin love the honk.
Right, so there's my title for getting the hits in. ADM shoots on Teddy Hart. I would say
Dory will come and murder me, but I don't think he can get in the country. So
that's how clickbait articles work, though.
You'll never believe what he said next.
Exactly. I've got Brody Adler next with any important or personal advice for trainees or those recently debuted. Well, we've shifted gears quite a lot here, but yeah.
That's a sensible question. How dare she?
So any advice?
Don't bother me. Just leave me alone. Advice. It depends. It depends on. There's such a big spectrum, I guess. The consistency probably is the thing that I've seen the difference between people who, because I've been there a long time now. I've seen people who come in who have got all the tools but don't make it to the end, and I've seen people come in. I'm not insulting anyone with this because I've told you it took me years, who come in and don't have all the tools and then they make it, because it's consistency. You've got to keep a belief, a kind of strong headset that you've got to keep at it. Because there is a lot of difficult, it's sore, you have a certain level of fitness to make sure everybody involved safe, and there's facets of it you might not be comfortable with. It's such a difficult thing where you've got performance, you've got athleticism, you've got whatever other parts of it. So just keep at it, just keep doing it, keep coming. Fail, don't worry about failing. If you're rubbish at something or you fail at it, or you can't get through it, just show up again the next day. That's just keep doing it. Nobody's going to ever, well, they shouldn't anyway, hold it against you. I would have more respect for someone who fails 10 times than someone who passes it 10 times. It's just that heart and desire and love. You have to love it to do it, because at times it sucks. It's the way of anything that's important to you. There's going to be times that are hard, but consistent, always do it. Work to your strengths, but also work on your weaknesses. I'm not saying you'll ever be great at something you're not particularly good at to start with, but if you're at least, you feel more comfortable in it, then if you're caught off guard, you've got that to lean on. But if someone's just starting out, if someone's not debuted yet, consistency. Get in there, get in your wrestling dojo or school or whatever you want to call it, as often as you can, repping out those small things that you need to know. For someone who's recently debuted, enjoy it. Don't worry too much. You're not going to get everything right away. There's things that only experience will teach you. There's things I've not even learned yet, or I'm still learning, because in the grand scheme of things, I'm not that experienced when you compare me to some of the other guys. So don't think you need to be perfect right away, because you don't. You'll discover it. And same thing, don't be afraid to make mistakes. I know in this day and age of everything being recorded, it's very easy to feel nervous and anxious about that. But if anything is flashed up, it only ever lasts a month or two, so you can always get past it.
Go back to the last episode that will go out in my timeline anyway, was with Colton Davis, like I said, and he said that you were one of the guys that really helped him, but that was more down to the like intricacies and how to use his height, because like I say, quite similar height, so 2 inches apart in that respect, which
the wrong way
which make all the difference, I'm sure. So I hear,
yeah, that's what some told.
It goes back to my point being, I find you being the conscience. I really should pick a word I could actually say of source wrestling, just being that godfather. I'm just going to stick with godfather. Everyone knows what I mean by saying that. Of source. So next one is Toasty. Somehow, Toasty the toaster asks, "How do you like your toast?"
Pass.
So I'll leave the Clyde River besties for a little bit. What's your favourite IT Crowd episode? That's from Jetstream Jack.
Oh, do you know, I was thinking about this, and it's so hard to pin down. I was talking to my wife as well. I'm like, how do you even pin it down? It's my second favourite comedy TV series ever. And it's a close, because number one's Father Ted, so they're very, very, very close.
Well, I was thinking about that. Yeah, IT Crowd's probably my top five. Fave five, as Booker T would say, of all time. And I'll tell you mine if it helps at all. It's the one where Jen's, there's so many episodes I'm thinking of, but the one where Jen's boyfriend, Peter File, where we meet Peter File.
The dinner party.
Yes.
That's one of that, yeah. The dinner party. It's
the best.
It's it was like act natural, more natural. I love the dinner party, Peter File. It's either going to be the dinner party or it's going to be a workouting. That's the one. A gay musical called Gay. That's a bit gay. Or the I love the one with the internet, like, because Douglas Renham is hilarious. Like, when he's dating the journalist that turns out to be transsexual, just fantastic.
I have the whole courtroom in Moscow and my love.
It's when she goes, "I loved you, you bastard." Oh, forgive me, sorry. Sorry,
you're quoting. I'll allow it. And I don't know what the people on podcast do. Don't swear, kids. I don't know.
Yeah. Do you know another good one? Actually, the German cannibal one. I'll tell you a side story on that. Right. So I remember. Have you ever seen that film that's on Netflix, The Outlaw King, the one with Chris Pine about?
It's in my list, but I have not watched it.
Right, so I did extra work for that. So I was up some field somewhere in Stirling, freezing cold, getting all my gear and stuff on, and this guy walks in and he's getting ready, and I'm staring at him, and I'm there myself, I don't know anybody, it's just loads of guys with long hair and beards. And then I think I must have actually said, I was like, "The German Cannibal!" It's him, he played like a monk or something in this film.
Netflix star ADM shoots on Teddy Hart.
Well, the funny thing is, I watched the film where my missus went, and I'm not in this scene, but see where the camera ends, just, I'm there. And then, like, the next scene coming, I'm just off camera then. So I'm not actually in it, but I was there.
As long as your name's in the credits somewhere, I'm sure it'll be fine.
Plus many extras, I'm sure it says somewhere.
But no, IT Crowd, it's one of those where I could... It's second. It's in my top five, because number one for me is Scrubs.
It might be top five. I've not watched it in so long. It is very quotable, to be fair.
Yeah, exactly. There's so many jokes. It was the one that just popped into my head is one I definitely can't put on the podcast, because I think it was one they probably cut out now with the word search. No, it's crossword. Was it defect or... break in the chain. I'll let you finish it. But yeah, so Scrubs, IT Crowd, Brooklyn Nine-Nine, all that kind of thing.
Oh yeah, well, who doesn't love Brooklyn Nine-Nine?
Modern Family would be in there.
Yeah, Modern Family's good as well. Like, for me, like Father Ted, Blackadder. Like, Blackadder's fantastic as well. I'm trying to think of some of the more modern ones. Like, all I can think of is the IT Crowd now. And Scrubs, you mentioned it. Let's get two thumbs and love Scrubs. This guy. Bob Kelso, how you doing?
Two thumbs and a funny voice. And this guy, I had the voice keep it fresh. So we've got KOE. I'm assuming both of them.
A voice.
I assume both of them wrote this, like one letter at a time. What's your favourite Thad quote?
I can't believe I've missed this out. Have you ever seen Blue Mountain State?
No,
I've not. It is like, so me and Mrs. MacAllan put it on one. So it's almost, it's based in like a fictional American college, and it's this American college team, and it's kind of American Pie-ish type humour. I thought it was going to be rubbish, you know, because you're looking for somebody to watch, we'll just put this on, right? And the Thad is... It's an absolute icon. Me and Kay Weedle, I think Taylor White's a fan as well. Absolutely love it and quote it all the time. But probably, I mean, he swear for this one, but as a quote as well. It's not bad. It's not a greedy swear word. There's an episode where the football team are feuding with the lacrosse team, and they're pranking each other. So the Thad's in the goat house, which is their kind of frat house. And his pal Larry's outside, and he's "Don't come in, Larry. those lacrosse assholes have turned the place into a house of mirrors. And he walks in, and gets lost. And it's just, that's one of my favourite lines in it.
I'll add it to my list. I've got loads of time tomorrow after I've spoken to Mammon.
That is good.
And final one I've got in is from Dean Ford. And I'm going to use some of my editing skills in this to make sure that everyone sees this photo. Basically, why are you obsessed with this photo? And as a bald man, I can reenact it.
That's the one.
What is it about that particular photo that tickles you?
So I don't like the. It is one of the best internet responses I have ever seen. Dean had a match against Luke Matthews, and Luke Matthews said something along the lines of like, you know, what something to do with his kicking us, like what have you ever, you know, something to do with, I can't remember specifically, something to do with, like, say he's martial arts, he's kick, what have you ever won? And Dean's reply was just that picture of the trophies. I just got to start laughing. I was like, oh, he's done you there. Look, man, you're just that's just, don't even need a promo. That's just, you're finished. Like, you guys were just finger poker doing that match because he's beat you before you even stepped in the ring.
Every time I see it,
what have you ever won?
All this,
I know.
I've gone to the point where I've started using it. It's like, I don't know why I'm using it. It just seems so funny to use. Just if Dean says something a bit stupid. Are just a bit brazen. You just go, okay, cool.
Dean could go on to win the WWE title, and I'd still wouldn't enjoy it as much as I enjoyed that reply to John's thing.
That would be the first response, though. I've just won the WWE title. Cool.
I actually, like, you know, they say when people say laugh out loud, they aren't actually laughing out loud. I was in tears. I was just, like, oh, he's done you there, man. He's absolutely.
I hadn't even heard your response, and I was. Giggling just because of you just giggling away at it as well. Yeah, so Luke did reply going, it's because of this that he learned to think before he typed.
So you ever won.
So yeah, so I don't know how or where it's going to pop up, but if you're watching it on the video feed, you will see this photo because I should have put it in the Dean Ford episode because it's incredible because I did ask him about it, which is coming up in season 2. I don't think we got to the bottom of why, so now we'll know if you're keeping track.
I don't even know if Dean remembers. That's why I find it so funny. Like I think I messaged him after it, and I was just like, that is absolutely class, mate. But I don't know if he remembers that, but every time I see it, I just remember it.
The Clyde River Besties, we're going to possibly discuss for a very short period of time.
If we must.
Yourself and Emily Hayden. Now, I don't want you to poke yourself and say nice things about her, but how did this friendship come about? Or I don't know what you would describe it as, but how did this duo come about?
Well, so if anyone who's ever met me in person, I have got a cutting sense of humour, is how you might put it. I'm an advocate of banter and you know, a little bit of friendly slagging, which is just how I interact with people. Once I know that they're all right with it, you know, and not to make fun of anyone, right, but there's no harm to it, obviously. Emily is in this world that is just oblivious to criticism or reality, whereby you say something to her and her answer is if you've said something else. So all of my banter and comments got more barbed and vicious and horrible on the spectrum to not good. And I still haven't managed to phase Emily. So she's obviously not well. I believe I called her the worst human being I've ever met.
Is that only because you haven't met Teddy Hart yet?
I don't know. I think I'd probably spend more time with Teddy Hart than I would with Emily Hayden, to be honest with you. I think I was. So I once said to her was, what was it? I think I said something like, she had a match and she came back, and I said, I don't have a problem with you wrestling, it's your personality that I think is loathsome. So to her she said, thanks bestie, and tried to hug me as she always does. So yeah, that's where it came from, is Emily Hayden's insane. That's really the punchline to this.
So for me, for anyone who's a big Scrubs fan, she's the Molly Clock to your Kelso, I suppose. Yes. You're trying to break her, yes, but she's just, yes, not breaking at all. Yes.
Yes. Who's got two thumbs and hates Emily Hayden? ADM, pleased to meet you.
So before we wrap up then, because as I say before every interview, I'll try to keep it half an hour to an hour.
Do you know what? I thought, I'm like, this will be an hour, no problem, Billy. Like, I don't really have a lot to talk about.
I know. It's. I mean, I'm still, I don't think I'll ever hit the heights of the Scotty Swift episodes where I've spoken to him for a combined total of 4 hours over two podcasts. To be fair,
I might be wrong, but I think Scotty's probably wrestled four times as long as I have. So I'd imagine he's got infinitely more stories and things than I have.
Maybe not four times. You may be on thin ice in NXT Butlins. Let's not break the ice entirely on pro wrestling. but yeah, it's. We'll go for the obvious ones, your goals. Of course, 2021, probably nothing's going to happen until goes when. Although you're still, have you got any more matches popping up on the WWE Network that you're aware of?
No, that's me. The lockdown, the proper tier lockdown kicked in just before I was supposed to go back in, actually. So, unfortunately, because I kind of know who I was maybe supposed to be wrestling, and I'm absolutely gutted that I didn't get the chance. But hopefully I will again.
So we'll just go end of 2021, 2022. What's your immediate goals? Say a 12-month span once you come back to wrestling.
Well, once we come back to wrestling, I think that I probably want to build something with a respect title, the same as I did with Source. I kind of want to take a story with that championship that I can say I'm proud of, as I did with the Source one, to try and kind of. I was going to say raise that brand. That's not really fair. Joe Henry was respect pro wrestling champion. I don't know. He's in Ring of Honor, so I don't know what I can do that Joe's not done, to be fair. But to do something with that, and I definitely want to wrestle for Disco again, 100%. I'd love to get involved with them again, and especially if I could do something with a bit of meat on it, story, something I can get my teeth into. Who wouldn't want more WWE Network appearances? Definitely like that. Especially when you look at some of the guys that they've got coming on that are on the network. There's a lot of them that I would like to work against. I'd love to work Dee again. I really enjoyed that. And even Skinner. I wouldn't mind pressing. I did have another good Source. Yeah, I think that there is a lot of things I've got to finish there. I want my title back. I was going to say it. I'm coming for Grant McIver. He's never beat me one-on-one, so try it. Griffin as well, he's a scumbag. I've still got Chokeslam Athena. I've got a laundry list of stuff I've got to do at Source. And probably try and help some of the young guys and stuff in there.
I mean, when you're speaking about Owen a Chokeslam to Athena, I think my last Source show that I watched, of course, is one of the governing ones because they're absolutely nuts, was that I was all for seeing you against Athena at some point, just because of the work as a height thing, because it's just like, it's one of the few people in Source that can actually look at you eye to eye-ish. So that would be certainly be something to see in whenever.
I would love to wrestle Athena. For example, my match with Sammy, I really enjoyed my match with Sammy. Actually, my favourite promo I've ever done was the one for the match with Sammy. Of all the ones I've done, that's my favourite.
Speaking of your promos, it's the former Sean Walker that does quite a bit of filming and editing. Is just you two brainstorming, or does he come to you with ideas, or vice versa? What's that?
Normally what it'll be is that I'll have a concept, and I'll know what I want to say, and I'll know kind of. Sometimes I'll know. I think most of the time I'll know location. I think maybe only a few times. I don't want to do Shauna disjustice, but the filming and the editing, that's like, you know, he's always a genius. So like he manages to take what I'm saying and what I want to portray and make it what it is, give it that sinister element to it, and that kind of cutaways and his filming style, I think really, really suits my delivery. So it's usually like the recording and the presentation of it is, you know, all Sean. Scott, he's not wrestling anymore, I can call him Scott, is all Scott. The content is all me.
I was going to call him by his real name, but then I saw his surname. I thought, I don't know if I could say that. So I was just like, yeah, I was just looking at it going, Sean Walker. That's an easy one. I can say that. So, and another nice, easy one to round up with is dream opponents. Say anyone active, Japan, AEW, WWE, whoever, who would be your, five? Who would be your top five opponents you'd want to face?
It's a tricky one. I'll try because I always like to kind of try and keep things a bit more like achievable, or something that could actually happen. I'll maybe throw one or two crazy ones in. Mark Coffey, top of the list. I've not wrestled Mark Coffey one on one. He's tremendous, and he's always been really, really helpful to me through my whole time in wrestling. Rampage Brown, probably. Would have been number one if it wasn't that, you know, I know Mark as a guy and he's somebody I want to work with. So Rampage Brown, I'd love to wrestle him. Try to think if I could do one that's hard to limit to five because I feel like I'm doing people a disjustice.
If you go over, I'm not going to hold it against you.
Okay, so like even guys, I've never had one-on-one with Stevie Boy, Wolfgang, Jester, then you could go to Gene Money. Oh, I'd love to wrestle Gene Money. I think who else we've got? Kuma. I've got this weird thing that I really want to wrestle Kuma. I don't know what it is. I just want to fight him. Like I've got this, I think about it sometimes, keeps me up at night. I'm like, I really want to wrestle Kuma. I think we could do something cool. I know he wants to fight me as well, so he spoke to me about it in a very polite way. He's a lovely man.
We've interviewed him. He was our penultimate guest in season one, and yeah, he's very nice, but I wouldn't want to cross
gentleman.
Him.
Absolute gentleman. Well, I do want to cross him, right? I'll just put it out there. I'll fight him. And then when you're talking like radical, crazy ones, like, you know, probably the guys that I'm fans of, like Adam Cole and Alistair Black, and anything else in my head. I'm trying to think if there's any female wrestlers I don't know if wrestle. I'm sure there is. I had my first ever training match with Viper, so I wouldn't mind wrestling Viper to see how far I've come.
Definitely. Rhea Ripley. Throw that in there.
Just... Oh yeah, I wouldn't mind that. Yeah, I wouldn't mind fighting that with some real. Or Billie Kay, because she stole all my moves. I remember watching NXT. I was like, I'll do that. And she said something else. I'm like, I'll do that as well. And she said something else. I was like, I'll do that too.
Billie Kay for me has got a lot of Emily Hayden energy. So I don't know if any of that is just going right. I might not be able to. I don't want to stand. I don't want to stay in the ring with Emily Hayden anytime soon. But Billie Kay's kind of got that kind of energy. Plus, like... she's nicking all my moves.
It'll be like the Spider-Man meme where they point to each other. Me, Emily Hayden, and Chris Hero. Chris Hero, there's one I'd love to fight. I'd love to fight Chris Hero. Thatcher as well. Sorry, I'm going crazy now.
No, so keep going. I don't mind. and any places. So you mentioned the ones in Scotland that you want to get to, Disco and back then, obviously, places that you've already been sourced and that. Again, worldwide. Is there any companies in particular that you've had your eye on thinking I could do something there?
I don't know. I'm probably, I don't know if it's a good or a bad thing. Like I very much take things as they come to me. I've never really, I've taken my stride. I've not reached out, but I've never thought, like, probably the best way to put it is that I never thought I would debut. So the fact that I'm here and doing it in front of people and people are hopefully enjoying it, then, you know, that's a bonus. But I'd love to be back to Target. Like, I was supposed to be back to Target before the lockdown happened. So I'd love to go back down and wrestle in Carlisle. That was fun down there before. I've done a couple of, like, PCW Academy shows where a couple of us went down. I wouldn't mind getting down to Preston again. I don't know. You've put me in the spot now. OTT, probably. I mean, who wouldn't want to work for OTT? The production's phenomenal. Really, really good lads over there as well. Plus, More Than Hype are pretty nice guys too. OTT. Other than that, I don't know.
Killer Zero, Kings of the North.
Yeah. Yeah. Aye, that would be pretty cool. The Kings of the North are good, man. They're really good.
Both of them. The thing that makes me laugh about Bonesaw, I don't know if it's just really bad just because he's Irish, but every time I see him, I think, Christ, Jim McDonald's looking pretty good. I just see him and it's like, Jim McDonald's looking. And I look at Jim McDonald and go, you look nothing alike. But I just, automatically, as soon as I see him, I just think, Jim McDonald's. So
Joe impressed me on that disco show. That's the, that was the first time I was on a show with Kings of the North. I think, I don't know if I did some stuff for ICW and they were there, but I think it was the first card I was actually wrestling on, and they were there, and I think it's the first time I met them, I introduced them, and Bonesaw was like, oh, Clyde River Killer, EDM. I'm like, how does he know who I am? I would never have even thought he would have known her, but he knew who I was. So I was like, that's, you know, and that impressed me. I thought that was quite polite.
They seem to be very, I mean, Damien Corbin follows us, and I'm like, why? All right, cool. So Jeff Jarrett follows us on Twitter, and I've messaged him, he didn't reply, so he's rude. But I don't know why. Anyway, right, so last question before we do those social media things, because like I said, we came on this thinking half an hour is fine. We're now an hour and a half in, so we'll start wrapping up. And then once the shows begin and you're reducing that 33% loss record down, we'll come back again and chat again. What's your favourite dinosaur?
My favourite dinosaur, Velociraptor.
I think that was second in our year-end awards. It's a very popular one. I'll mention.
Yeah, I think it depends on age, right? Because see if you're old enough that the original Jurassic Park was when you were younger, then Velociraptors are badass.
My favourite answer still so far is Harmony Sky with turkey dinosaurs. Just the sheer inventiveness of it is still going to be my favourite answer. I don't know if anyone will ever top it. But Velociraptors, Triceratops came up quite a lot in our initial episodes. And of course, classic.
And Allosaurus is pretty good as well. Pretty cool.
See, everyone just comes in here and makes up dinosaurs.
Allosaurus is, though, that's the one that's bigger than a T-Rex, isn't it? Am I remembering?
I have no idea. For someone who asks this question in most episodes, I should really have a better knowledge of dinosaurs. I remember walking with dinosaurs and getting the wee, in the cereal box, you would get the wee scratchy cars, that like hologram ones. And I got really excited about seeing a dinosaur in Disneyland, even if it was Rex. Still amazing. But some people have come on here with just wild ones that they've went, I've actually told them they've made it up. And they've messaged me after going, no, Wikipedia article. This is a dinosaur. I think Nate Stevenson came up with the weirdest one. I can't remember what it was called, but he literally messaged me afterwards going, no, this is it. Oh, all right, okay.
How dare you doubt my dinosaur knowledge?
Exactly, that's how it felt. Anyway, right. So before I keep you any longer, where can people find you on social media?
I'm on Twitter. I think it's D_MacAllan, I think. I'm on Instagram. I think it's also D_MacAllan, but I might be wrong, because caught me off guard. Normally I've got this stuff ready, but I completely forgot that as the lockdown and stuff, and you were like, you know, we'll have a chat. I actually forgot I was a wrestler and that people would actually need to find me to see my stuff.
This is for the IT Crowd podcast.
Yeah, try to turn it off, turn back. I know. Oh, I'd love that. That'd be amazing. I've got a hot ear. I think it's D_MacAllan on Twitter and on Instagram. But if not, just search for Alexander Darwin. It's MacAllan.
Are you on TikTok?
No, I'm not on TikTok. There's nothing wrong with being on TikTok. You've got to move with the things. So
I've joined TikTok and I've put up four. I've just got loads of wrestling videos, so I'm not putting myself on just yet. Although I want any excuse to have this in a video because I love it. For those that are listening, it is Mjolnir.
Mjolnir. Yeah. I actually dressed up as Thor for Halloween before a couple of times because I had my own Mjolnir as well.
My plan this year was to, obviously, till the world ended, I was going to be Fat Thor from Endgame. That was my, because I thought cardigan, comfy joggers, easy. That's
was it Lebowski Thor?
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one I wanted to go with. Anyway, before we start spiraling again, we'll go and enjoy a bowl of Smarty cereal and call it a day. So if anyone wants to contact you, you give your details. But yeah, thank you for joining me on the SWN podcast.
No worries, Billy. Anything.